Good afternoon. A pilot has died and his passenger has been flown to hospital after their gyrocopter crashed in a paddock in regional Victoria. Stephanie Anderson with more.
Emergency services and investigators have spent hours combing through the wreck here in Goulburn Weir, just outside of Nagambie in regional Victoria, after that small gyrocopter crashed into a paddock just after 7 this morning.
It's a small, I think, open cockpit style gyrocopter, so not a helicopter, but along the same. It wasn't a business thing. I believe it was a personal fight, and they were known to each other.
Police say it took another 45 minutes for the alarm to be raised with emergency services. They won't confirm who called it in, but SES, CFA, Ambulance Victoria and police all responded, arriving to the scene around 8:40.
Sort of thing's always confronting. This is still being investigated. We still don't know the circumstances of what's occurred. So I don't want people jumping at shadows.
Investigators say the pilot sadly died at the scene. His passenger was airlifted to the Royal Melbourne Hospital.
People just going about their leisure activities, and unfortunately one of them might be returning home and the other one's still got a battle in front of them.
Victoria Police will prepare a report for the coroner, with the incident to then be referred to the Australian Sport Rotorcraft Association.
To another aircraft tragedy, and investigators are making their way to the scene of a fatal plane crash in outback Queensland, where 3 people have been killed. Live to Claire Todd Hunter in Brisbane. Claire, they were on their way to help firefighters when the plane went down.
They were, Dougal. This was a firefighting mapping aircraft being contracted out to the Queensland Fire and Emergency Services, used to provide some critical mapping surveillance for those crews on the ground. Now, it was on its way from Toowoomba, where it had been battling fires in the Western and Southern Downs for the last few weeks, up to Mount Isa to continue fighting those blazes. But tracking shows it came very close to its destination when it came to a sudden stop at McKinley, dropping nearly 18,000 feet per minute in that very sudden stop. The wreckage later found engulfed in flames, and this loss now being felt by emergency services crews right across Australia.
The aviation community is in mourning, and part of that aviation community includes our own personnel from the Queensland Fire Emergency Services, as well as the New South Wales Rural Fire Service and right down into Victoria.
Now, we do have flags being flown at half-mast at emergency services buildings across the state today, and we've heard a number of tributes, including from our Premier Anastasia Palaszczuk, who says the crew on board this aircraft have been doing everything they could to protect Queenslanders. I send my heartfelt condolences to the many people who have been impacted by this shocking incident. Well, the company who contracted this crew out to Queensland was based in Victoria, so we've also heard from Victoria's Premier today.
This is a terrible tragedy, and our condolences and thoughts go to the loved ones of the 3 Victorians who have been killed in this terrible accident.
As for exactly how this happened, Dougal, that will take some time to determine. This crash site is located in very rough terrain, very difficult to access. Police are on site, but they don't have specialist teams arriving until tomorrow. The ATSB not expecting to take over until next week.
Okay, Claire, thanks for the update. Well, Anthony Albanese is talking trade today in Shanghai after touching down overnight, becoming the first Australian PM to visit China in 7 years. Tomorrow, he'll meet with the Chinese president in Beijing.
What he can expect from me is a continuation of the patient, calibrated and deliberate way of engaging in Australia's national interest. And what I expect from President Xi is the same.
The Trade Minister is also there, saying he's confident China is on the brink of removing remaining sanctions on Australian beef and lobster. Thousands have rallied in Israel in support of more than 240 people held hostage by Hamas in Gaza. Europe correspondent Karianne Greenbank is in Tel Aviv.
It's been almost a month now since the Hamas massacre and mass kidnappings of October 7, and once again tonight, the families of the hostages have gathered here in Tel Aviv to plead with the Israeli government to do whatever it can to bring their loved ones home. US Secretary of State Antony Blinken has been meeting leaders from Lebanon, Qatar and Jordan in Amman after his latest visit to Tel Aviv, saying the US is focused on the release of hostages and continuing to push for humanitarian pauses in the fighting, saying he believes more than 100 trucks carrying critical aid have crossed from Egypt to Gaza today, but acknowledging that's not nearly enough. A US official says around 400,000 civilians remain in northern Gaza, which has now been cut off from the south as the Israeli military formed a ring of steel around Gaza City and fighting turns to urban warfare. The average person in Gaza is now living on 2 pieces of bread per day, and nowhere in the region is safe. That's according to the UN. Its Secretary General again calling for an immediate ceasefire to let aid in. But Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has ruled out a ceasefire. He said yesterday he won't consider it until all hostages have been released. Israel began bombing Gaza after Hamas killed more than 1,400 people in Israel and kidnapped more than 200 others. Gaza's Hamas-run health ministry says the death toll there now stands at more than 9,400.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky believes the war in Gaza is taking away focus from his country's struggles with Russia. He's also denied that fighting in Ukraine has reached a stalemate. The European Union has recommended an additional $80 billion in aid until 2027. Well, churchgoers in the tight-knit Victorian community in the southeast have gathered for the first time since mushroom cook Aaron Patterson was charged with murder. Gillian Lantouris was there.
Currumburra locals filed into the Baptist Church for their regular Sunday service, but there were a few notable absences. Reverend Ian Wilkinson, the sole survivor of the alleged toxic mushroom lunch, still not well enough to lead his parishioners. Instead, he's been replaced temporarily by another pastor.
We have a very close-knit and tight community here, has been deeply affected by it.
Another absentee includes Simon Patterson. His estranged wife, Erin Patterson, was charged on Thursday with plotting to kill him a total of 4 times. The 49-year-old is also accused of murdering her former in-laws, Don and Gail Patterson, along with Heather Wilkinson, by serving them a deadly meal containing poisonous mushrooms in July. She's also charged with attempting to murder Ian Wilkinson, who was also at the lunch, but recovered. Since the homicide squad made their arrest, the Currumburra community has once again been thrust into mourning.
A lovely, warm community, and everyone's welcome in Currumburra. Thankfully, because of the nature of the people of this town, that they are being supported.
Neighbours have revealed Ms. Patterson hosted guests at her Leongatha home the night before she was arrested. The mother of two has now spent her third night behind bars, likely taken to a female-only maximum security prison in Melbourne. Ms. Patterson is set to face court again in the regional town of Morwell in May next year.
3 pedestrians have been taken to hospital after being hit by a car in Melbourne. A man and woman suffered critical head injuries in the incident in Abbotsford. The third person was taken to hospital in a stable condition. The driver stopped at the scene and is assisting police.